Good evening, Bedford. Welcome to Bedford Common. My name is Rich Doherty, and about an hour before this meeting, I was had an envelope out, which I just opened, and Julie Turner called. I could hardly hear her. She was losing her voice and said, would you do this for me this evening? I said, well, why? And went through the whole process. It turns out I wasn't first on her list, but there were others who couldn't make it. And on the back of this envelope, she sketched out what we should do this evening. So this segment here is the government segment, and we have four guests this evening. It turns out they're here once a month. And we have down at the end of the table there, we have Brad Hafer, who is chair of the school committee for five more weeks.
About that, yeah, till the end of June.
And then we have Steve Steele, who is chair of the finance committee for
at least one more session before we have an election. Before we have an election,
yeah. And you could possibly say, I'll do it again. Possibly.
We'll see what comes up.
Okay, and the chair of the selectmen is Mark Siegenthaler, to my right. And here representing the planning board is Amy Lloyd. So, town meeting has just finished as of last Tuesday evening. Do you notice we whizzed through an $81 million budget with 27 to 30 line items in the time it took Steve to read it? When we got done, we voted on it. Basically, it was the time it took Steve to read it. So, we're going to be talking about what the went on during town meeting. Mm-hmm. Each of the committee chairs is going to talk about some of their hopes, some of the issues, some of what we hope will make Bedford continue to be a great town. So without me talking all the time, why don't we start with you, Steve, the finance committee, to kind of put a shell around all the stuff that we do, and the other three members can arm wrestle and see who wants to go next.
Actually, I do want to urge the voters. I actually had a presentation during the meeting. I'm not sure if you can see it. I would urge everybody, if you have the time, look at that presentation, because it should be probably online on YouTube or whatever Bedford TV puts it out on. I'm just going to kind of give some highlights of what I spoke about during that presentation. Like Rich mentioned earlier, we had an $81 million budget in total. That, an early estimate of that is, that'll probably be around a 4.6% increase, an average increase in real estate taxes for most citizens. There's not just tax rates, there's also evaluation. So on average, we're guessing around a 4.6% increase. Some of the highlights are the schools. Of that 81 million schools, was a little over 36 million of it. Selectmen were about $16 million. Another couple of high items is insurance and benefits were almost $11 million. Mm-hmm. And principal interest on bonding and debt, not so much this year, but in prior years, just south of $8 million, okay? So all of those items put together will really result in, we're guessing, around a 4.6% increase in taxes. Some of the unusual things this year is we had to make up for a lot of snow deficit, because we had a snowy winter. We actually had to put in around $650
million. $650 million or 1,000?
Million.
Oh.
No, I'm sorry, $650,000 okay. In our budget that we really had to, basically it's money we spent in 15 and have to pay for it in 16. The state, I think, is recommending that we could do it over 2 years. We'd like to pay it off in 1 year. Another issue that we ran into is the money that was promised in the original governor's budget for Hanscom funding was pulled back, so we actually had to remove the revenue from those dollars and actually put it back and pull it out. So we gave the schools the monies, but us as a town, we have to bear the hit on that if it does come to fruition. Some of the items I kind of want to go over is, I think, Rich, you may have had a question on free cash.
Yes, I did.
We actually started with free cash of $4.8 million, okay? What free cash is, it's really the difference between what we've estimated in revenue and what we receive for receipts, and what we estimated for expenses and what we really spent. So in theory, from a governmental perspective, free cash is a good thing, because it's money you have now that you can spend in the future. Okay. Of that free cash, we spent almost $1 million of that free cash to help fund the town hall project last fall. So that was 2015 money. Okay. In 2016, we spent $3.1 million of the $4.8 million. That is not being used to fund the operating budgets. It's being used to fund the one-time items. Yeah. Most of the time, it's capital. Mm-hmm. So we're actually sitting on a little more than $800,000 of monies that we can use in future years. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a little kitty that can be utilized for unusual situations, which may happen this year.
Mm-hmm. And a good habit that we have is to use that free cash primarily for capital, one-time type items, yes, not for operating.
Well, actually, state law does say we cannot use it to balance our budget.
Okay.
So we will find capital items to utilize those monies for. So they don't want you to squirrel away money and use it to balance your operating budget, because the operating budget doesn't go away.
Okay.
Another couple of key items are our debt ratio is at 9.4%, which is a little south of where the high limit of what finance wants to go to. So we are still in that range. Our stabilization is almost $3 million, which is around the 3% range. We'd like to see it between 2 and 6, so we'd like to see it go up. We didn't add any money this time because of the Hanscom situation, and we wanted to make sure that the department budget would fund accurately. As we get a better estimate on our revenue, we're going to reconsider putting monies into that in the fall time meeting as well. Mm-hmm. And one other big item is we actually spent a little over $4 million on capital items.
That's pretty high relative
that is,
to
that is
years
that is time. Higher than past years. And the committees and our CapEx spent an extremely lot of time to really vet those projects out, and we felt that if their process in place, we had no problem kind of planning for that. Mm-hmm. So we feel that all the parties involved, it was a good plan all across the board. We're glad that we came to an agreement with the schools, which is very good. We came to an agreement with the selectmen, and I know we went low in the beginning and then we worked our way up, but I think it's a process that does seem to work.
Okay. So that tells us where $81 million is going, and 36 of that, plus some capital items, is planned to be spent by our schools. So Brad, why don't you address some of that?
Rich, you're right. As you know, we just finished ATM, as Steve said, the school budget was about $36.6 million. We were able to achieve the revised FinCom guideline. Mm-hmm. That represents about a 3.85% increase comparable year to year. We had some adjustments, but 3.85% increase over last year. Everyone should be getting the Bedford Public Schools budget newsletter shortly. Normally it would be out before ATM, but because of the way the process went this year, by the time it got printed and mailed, you can also find it on various websites, and the Citizen, I think, reposted it. So we're pleased with the budget. Glad we could come to resolution, and thank everyone for supporting it. As you mentioned, there are also a number of capital items. Technology was a key component of the school's capital items for this year, and there's three subcomponents of that for infrastructure, printers and smart boards, as well as our PC replacements. And as you can imagine, technology is a huge portion of the educational delivery model that we have today. Mm-hmm. And so the technology piece, both to create the wireless networks or the wired networks, plus the devices that the students have and all the technology in the room, it will continue to be a large item, or a relatively large item. As years pass, it was transferred into the capital item this mm-hmm. year, which is part of why that number was $4 million. But as we look at the six-year plan and found ways to fund that, I think it'll all be very successful. If anyone's curious about how we leverage our technology in the school, we'll have the technology showcase coming up on April 8th.
April 8th.
Evening of April 8th at the high school.
Okay. It's that's a great called technology showcase.
Right. We had one last year. It was very successful. Mm-hmm. Get to see students in action using the technology, various grade levels all the way from Davis School through the high school. Okay. So it's a lot of fun. You know, I think, as I mentioned about the budget, there were additional items for some behavioral needs in the high school. We have some new kindergarten enrollment issues that we'll continue to face. People know about the monitors. We've talked about this on the program previously. We were able to bring two programs for special education in-house, which is always a benefit to those students, and that also happens to be a cost savings mechanism. So we're pleased with that. Once again, we remain one of the few, very, very few towns in the state of Massachusetts that doesn't have fees for buses or for our sports or extracurricular activities. So we're happy with that. And again, we're thankful for the town support for all of that. So Overall, we're happy to have that behind us. The rest of our agenda for the remainder of the year gets a little bit easier at this point, but there's...
You're going back to education.
Going back to education. And, you know, if the weather's cooperative, we'll get our spring sports in sometime before May.
Okay, okay. Great. Thanks, Brad. Now, I would like, if it's okay with you, Mark, for Amy to go next. And since you are here representing the selectmen, our governing body in town, you could sort of give your report and kind of pull it all together, if that's okay.
Sure, it's fine.
Okay, so Amy is here representing the planning board, and you don't really have a specific budget that we vote on or talk about, but you can tell us some of the things that are on our horizon that might cost money.
The numbers that I'm going to talk about are the numbers of developmental cases that are coming before us.
Okay.
It seems that the recession years, since they have ended, there is a dam bursting of pent-up demand to do development. And we are, or I should say the staff, is absolutely swamped. Every type and scale of development we've got pending before us. Some of them have filed already. Many are just in the exploratory, see what we want, see what's possible phase. Some of the residential projects in front of us, there are a number of small subdivisions. One of them will probably be a conventional subdivision, one possibly a cluster, and there's an ANR, which means approval not required, that we just heard about today. I don't have any more information than that on it. There is a possible cluster type development near, not in the depot area, but near the depot area, and this will be the town's first. And it's a developer that has a lot of experience and intends on building smaller units, many of which are going to be aimed at the empty nester market. And I think a lot of people will be very pleased.
Now, is that
if that comes to fruition?
To be yet planned?
That is still in the exploratory phase.
Okay.
None of these have been officially filed yet. You know, when a project is officially filed, there is a clock that starts ticking that we are required by law to hear the case in a certain amount of time. On the commercial side, there is another proposal for a small mixed-use project that will complete the Blake Block. This is the old country store that many of you know of, and that has been purchased, and it's a minor amendment. It's basically to redo the whole place. I think there's some paving that they want to ask to put in. It's going to look much nicer and be a viable business of what kind, I don't know yet. We will find out. But that's nice that's finally going to be fixed up. There is a potential, and this is in the earliest stages as well, a potential new mixed-use project, and this is in the depot area, unlike the cottage that I talked about a moment ago. The initial proposal is for luxury condos, including some proportion that are, again, specifically tailored for empty nesters. So developers seem to be hearing our plea for, please respond to this need, this market. There is also, we're getting close to a filing for a cafe or retail establishment that's going to go into the building where the bike store is, in the back of that building. That was renovated extensively last year, and the owner is looking for tenants right now, and that will come before us for a usage.
Another cafe, eh?
Well, he'd like a cafe or retail. I think he's being very careful about who he chooses. He wants a really high-quality tenant.
This town needs a good pub.
It's not going to be a pub. Think good coffee instead of good beer.
I think of the English days of wandering through the English countryside and having all those meetings in pubs and watching their towns work out of pubs. It wouldn't work very well here, would it? Go ahead.
I don't know. Depends on the pub, maybe. Many people have heard that there is a property owner who is exploring the possibility of building a restaurant in Great Road, right in the center of town. The planning board's role would be to conduct a site plan review, and I wanted to just take a moment, because so many people are curious about this project, about this proposal. Nothing is a done deal yet, but I wanted to just sort of clarify a few points, because there have been so many questions. Because of where it is, there are three bodies that have somewhat overlapping jurisdiction. Initially, the Zoning Board of Appeals are the ones that would determine whether or not this parcel would be would be allowed to have a special permit to run a restaurant. That is a special permit use. It is not allowed by right. If that were allowed, then it would come to the planning board to do a site plan review, and then it would go to the HDC, who would have jurisdiction over the architecture and some aspects of the landscape where it specifically pertained to historical features like stone walls. The thing that I want to sort of clarify for people is that in every zoning district in town, there are uses defined, and they're specifically defined. And some of those uses are allowable by right, and some of those uses are allowed only if they are given a special permit after consideration of several specific factors by the ZBA. In this instance, as I said before, a restaurant is a special permitted use. However, there are some uses in that district that are allowed by right. For instance, an office building would be allowed by right. And so the owner could potentially choose to build an office building, in which case it would come before the planning board for a site plan review, which is compared to a ZBA special permit, a site plan review is a relatively minor jurisdictional piece. And then it would also, of course, still go before the HDC.
Okay. And so how much more we have here?
It's cogent for
what we want to do.
There are several major redevelopment plans that are not getting underway physically, but being in the planning stages over across Route 3. Carlton Willard is proposing the addition of more independent living units, and that would require a rezoning process for a small targeted area. Mm-hmm. And then the staff and board are also still crafting a transportation demand management regulation proposal. Traffic is on everyone's minds. We're preparing studies for major amendments to the town's outdated industrial zoning and other land use studies, and I could go on, but I'll stop
busy,
there.
Busy, busy.
We're very busy.
And it's primarily driven by a robust economy.
Yes.
Okay. Well, it's great to have a robust economy. Perhaps you guys don't know this, but Nancy and I were interested in one of these Bedford Crossing units. They're all gone. They all have been spoken for as of September 1st.
I've heard that.
So if we build housing of that nature, the 800 and some square feet is the lowest at around $300,000, and 1,200 square feet is the highest at around $450,000, they'll go like wildfire. People want to live in this town, sell their $700,000, $800,000 house, invest half of it into a place to live, and take the other half and plow it back into Bedford. Is that what you plan?
I hope so.
Okay. Mark, kind of wrap the formal part of this up for us, and maybe we'll have time for some discussion when you get
done. All right, well, I'll try to be quick then. Hopefully your viewers were either at town meeting or will have watched town meeting, but I think it's probably worth highlighting that a lot of discussion about capital projects, and I just want to reinforce that the town's changed its approach to capital projects just a little bit now, emphasizing much more, I think as Brad pointed out, a six-year capital plan, much more about trying to map out and anticipate the order and the necessity for projects in advance, as opposed to just having a one-year application process and see who can get to the top of the list and get funded. And I think that's important for people to know that there's a much more thoughtful and evaluative process going on in mapping out what projects need to happen and when they need to happen and why. So that only reinforces the kinds of things that are going to be happening for the schools and for other aspects of the town government that I think are very important. There were, of course, a couple of other standalone projects, like more work on the sewer main between here and Lexington. People remember that it broke a little more than a year ago and had to be fixed in the middle. Now it has to be fixed on the ends, on either end. And of course, the Crosby Drive cell tower standpipe painting project was also approved, and we appreciate that. Going forward on some other issues, town meeting passed the proposed home rule petition to the legislature requesting additional liquor licenses. If the town needs a good pub, we would have to have a liquor license to give to a good pub, which we don't have now. So with luck, the legislature will do its thing. We'll work with our two members and then on with the rest of the legislature and keep moving that along. So we'll have greater ability, as people said at town meeting, to attract a series of restaurants serving a variety of tastes and styles, and be able to provide them with a liquor license that they really need in order to have a viable full service restaurant. A couple of other things of note for people are, I think people are aware that there's a study underway of the condition at Fawn Lake. A variety of science and conservation and environmental factors are going on there. We've appointed a citizens committee to take that information in and try to turn that back into recommendations, try to evaluate what the experts can tell us about what the possible futures are for Fawn Lake and what the town may or may not want to consider to do about that. And then a couple of other just scheduling notes. There's a multicultural festival at the high school on April 12th. So
April 12th,
if you're watching,
okay,
right? If you're watching us now in the early part of the month, you still have time to get there.
I have a table there, as a matter of fact.
Excellent, excellent. And of course, just before that, poll capping is Saturday the 11th. And one more note just for people to really, if you're really pining away for summer, it appears that our fireworks display will have been displaced from the VA this year because they'll be underway with some housing that's being built there. It's now planned to be held here in the center campus, somewhere amidst the high school, middle school, library, that whole area. We will.
We did that about 20 years ago.
I remember that, actually.
And I had to put my hair up.
Suffice to say, the town manager has been in discussions, meaningful discussions with the fire department to make sure this is really something we can do, we're allowed to do, and it's safe to do. Yeah. And we're headed towards that. So that's a little far out into the future, but I think it's actually kind of sounds like fun to be here in the center of town, okay, assuming people don't park all over people's driveways or something. But
so what's coming down the pipe that can get in the way of what it is we would like to do in Bedford? The Finance Committee has worked hard at keeping this town at a high bond rating and a town that's successful financially. And it didn't happen because it did it by luck. It was hard work. What do you see, Finance Committee folks, see as issues that are really going to be tough?
Well, you know, I think the issue this year was really that the Hanscom funding, and that really threw a curveball at the last second, where we were anticipated to get that money, and then it got kind of pulled off underneath us. And in order for us to get the budget to balance, we had to move a few things out of the capital article and reconsider them in the fall. We had to bond some things. The Finance Committee really wasn't in favor of doing a lot of bonding, but we felt that if CapEx believed that we really need these items, we have no problem doing bonding for that. Mm-hmm. I think if we had our druthers, it would have been nice not to bond those things and to build our stabilization fund back up to a level that we'd feel comfortable with. And that's, the Finance Committee likes to put money aside and not in any committee's hands, but in the voters' hands, put it in the stabilization fund. We think that's a great place to have it. And the money, if you really need the money, we let the voters decide.
Rich, if I may, Brad and Steve may know this, but it's my understanding that our legislators are still working on this. There is still a supplemental budget bill pending in the legislature for fiscal year 15, and our school money has been added to that. Don't know whether it'll survive that process.
$800,000?
$516,000, yes.
Yeah.
And there's still the opportunity for it to be attached to the budget that has not yet cleared out of the House. The governor's budget has been filed, but the House and the Senate haven't filed their budgets yet.
What's the process behind that,
there's
Mark?
Some process.
You're down there every day, right? City every day.
Not in that branch.
what's going on? Why is this happening? Such that we're not the only town in the country that has to do this. So other towns are being affected probably in the same manner, or even worse, in terms of educating students that are related to the military. What's going on?
It's actually only two towns.
There's only in the whole country.
In Massachusetts. Well,
I know.
This is state.
Yeah.
This is state money.
State money has to come in from to educate students on federal properties, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Right.
So it's federally mandated. Is that correct? Let's see if we can understand.
Actually, I have a feeling that it's a state mandate that we educate all children in Massachusetts. So okay. I see it as, and I could be wrong about this, this is a state obligation to educate all children that come in any town in Massachusetts.
Okay.
You may know more about that, but I saw this as a state issue when the governor pulled $1 million out. That happens to be split between Bourne and Bedford.
Yeah. And so the leverage has to be done at the state level.
Yes.
It seems that our senators used to help us out, our national senators help us out on this issue.
Yes.
Are they helping us out?
Well, you're mixing again between state and federal.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I know.
So the federal system is what it is. The impact aid
right.
is
yeah.
what we receive.
Right.
And that's
at the state level, the shift that happened was, rather than being on an ad hoc basis, our legislators managed to get Bourne and Bedford written into the law.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
But it was a section of the law where, when the budget is not going well at the state level,
okay.
the governor
right.
has the
yeah.
ability to then pull back. Yeah. That's what happened for last year's money.
Mm-hmm.
The current governor chose in his proposal not to put the money back in.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't mean that the legislature will come to the same conclusion at the end of the fiscal year 16.
So this is probably an issue every year for your committee, that have to somehow or another grind this in.
Well, in the past, the money went right to the schools.
Yeah.
Yes, ultimately, the town would have to help fund that if it didn't come. I mean,
yeah.
in the end, the rules haven't really changed. It's really the direction. And
yeah.
Bedford as a town has always committed mm-hmm. that if the schools have problem getting these funding, we're there as a backup plan.
Okay.
So we're still committed to that.
And a number of people have been working for years at both the federal level and with the military directly, as well as the state, to try to get this funded. And
right.
as we've already said, we finally got it written in as a law, which changed the process of the money coming straight to the schools to coming into the town first. And then that was pulled from us,
yeah.
ironically, mm-hmm. At the last minute. So that's why we did some of this
right.
End of the process yeah. reshuffling.
Mm-hmm.
But we got there. I mean, we're continuing the effort. There's plans
okay.
to go down and meet Beacon Hill with various
yeah.
constituents.
It seems like out of $81 million, it's a small amount. But, you know, that's hard to come by. But Amy mm-hmm. has put in through the planning board, what, another 50 to 60 million over the next 3 or 4 years of tax base?
Me personally?
Well, you're fine. Can you do that personally? And there's some money. Except I never have been able to figure out, when we collect the taxes from property taxes or businesses, how much of that really needs to be put in place to maintain those businesses and the roads and the water and all that they take? It should be break even in the end, in my opinion, but we like to have a high tax base because it gives us more money.
With some caveats. we're not Houston. We
yeah.
don't want to be Houston where right. anything goes.
Okay.
But we do have a very healthy tax base,
yeah,
actually.
At this point.
Compared to many towns that rely much more heavily on residential tax revenue, Bedford has a well-balanced tax base, and we just need to keep working on how to make sure that the business community is happy with the town services they get and with the permitting process and all the other things that they rely on in order to remain here and do their work and be a healthy part of it.
Anything else that's important for the town to hear about our government after town meeting?
I have one thing.
Yes.
We need more people to attend town meeting.
We do,
we
don't we?
Shouldn't have to make a phone call to get 100 people. I urge you, please, please, please attend.
What Steve is talking about, audience, is it takes 100 out of almost 6,800 voters. Is that right? Or is it more than that? Only takes 100 to have a quorum at town meeting. And I noticed about 10 of us running around calling people. I got 3. How many did you get?
My children
we were 16
home, yeah.
down.
I didn't
first start.
Have much luck.
John Sills put a tweet out to all of his Bedford school teachers.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them showed up. I noticed.
Yep.
So yes, come to town meeting.
That's
otherwise, opinion. We're going to have an RTM just almost like we do now because it's the same people all the time doing the same thing. Anything else, guys? Thanks. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
And I hope Julie is able to run this meeting next time because she does a heck of a lot better job of it than I'm trained to do.
No, don't tell yourself you are.
Okay. Stay with us for some folks from the Rotary to talk about their meals packing project and to meet our new Bedford Minuteman editor, who's been here since the 1st of December, on the next segments.
Bedford TV programming is brought to you with the support of Whole Foods Market in Bedford, the Goddard School, and Callahan's Karate Studio.
And welcome back to Bedford Common. The guest for this portion of the show is Joy Richard, who is the Bedford Minuteman editor and has been since the 1st of December.
Correct, yes.
2014. So she's been on the job here almost 4 months. So tell us how you got here.
So I came to the Bedford Minuteman by way of Central Massachusetts. I was a reporter for about 5 years out in the Webster, Dudley, Oxford area, which is in South Central Massachusetts on the border of Connecticut. I wrote for a daily paper and a weekly paper out there. And I had, in between the two, been a stringer or a correspondent for some of the other Wicked local papers.
Okay, and you came out of Salem State College Communications School, is that correct?
Yes, I studied journalism, public relations, and advertising, and I ended up picking journalism because it was my favorite thing to do right. I really enjoyed it a lot, and I've really enjoyed my time here so far.
So is this the job you hoped for when you graduated?
Yeah, I think so. I've always wanted to write features for magazines, but I've really come to love news since I've been writing for newspapers for the last 5 or 6 years now. So it's exciting to be here.
So how was your interview at the New York Times News Bureau?
Oh, it was great, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. You may end up there someday, huh?
We'll see, yeah.
Okay. So what have you found out about Bedford that you find most interesting as a news reporter?
Well, I found out a lot about Bedford. I had heard the town's name before, but I'd never been previous to coming in. I went to school up on the North Shore, so I kind of was familiar with the area, but I didn't know a lot of the history. I knew that you guys were tied into the Revolutionary War, and that was about it. But now that I've come, I've learned that there's a lot of great small town activities and really traditional activities that kind of define you guys as a town, like pole capping and the flag being the first. So that stuff's been fun to learn. Yeah, it's been great.
Okay, so someone's told you a little bit about some of our history.
Yeah.
Have you heard any of the bad stuff?
Not yet.
Maybe there isn't any to report on.
Well, huh? I certainly hope not.
So now the way you go about doing your job as the Bedford Minuteman editor, you have other people working with you for the various news that you do report, like attending committee meetings, going to fires, following the ambulances. Are those the kind of things you do?
It's really just me as the writer and editor. I do most of the reporting. I do have correspondents, though, that help me with municipal meetings. I wanted to have them continue to do that while I learned more about, each municipal branch here in town. And then I've started to do those kind of meetings myself. The most recent one that I went to was the second night of town meeting. So the budget was voted on, and OPEC was voted on, and all those topics. And so I'll be doing more of those meetings, splitting them with my correspondent, but I do a little bit of everything.
Okay, and the paper was published today. Is it published on Thursday?
Correct.
So what did you say about the town meeting budget?
Well, we had our first story from the first night come out where they voted on actually the cable TV. So that was the story for the first article. The second article is going to be about how the budget was approved almost unanimously. There was only one negative vote, and that OPEC was put through with a unanimous vote.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So now, perhaps this is a question that has no specific answer or unfair. What is the circulation of the Bedford Minuteman in Bedford? Do you have a feel for that?
I don't. That's one thing I haven't found out yet. I've been so busy trying to learn about, all the town boards and get to know the people, that that's actually one thing that I haven't learned quite yet. So that'll be on my list to do.
Many of us do not get the paper copy anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So we have an online version of it, and all the reporting is done there. So I don't know how you know what that circulation is, probably. It used to be huge, and I don't know exactly to what extent it covers the whole town anymore. You have a little competition now in terms of news reporting from the Bedford Citizen.
We do, yes.
So the circulation, I guess I wish it were higher. I guess there was more newsworthy items to report on, but welcome here to our town.
Yeah.
So what are your fondest hopes for your tenure as the editor of the Bedford Minuteman for?
Well, I hope to have a really balanced paper. I hope to have a little bit of the municipal news, education. I really was looking to get back into the schools. People wanted to see more education reporting. I hope to have the feature side of things, the human interest and, the pieces about people in Bedford. I love to do those. That was my specialty back at my other paper.
Okay.
It's a great way to get to know just everybody who lives in town, not just the administrators and officials. So balance is my goal.
So balanced news reporting in Bedford.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we could use that.
Yeah, it's always nice.
So as you move on into your first year, that'll be coming up in December,
mm-hmm.
You'll be reporting on the summer camps. You'll be reporting on the sports?
I don't personally do sports myself. We actually have a sports department who does all that good stuff. And we have a lot of photographers that go out and cover things. Like this weekend, we'll have somebody out covering the Easter egg hunt over at, I believe it's the Davis School. We had someone last week go out and do photos of the interfaith challah, I hope I'm saying that right, bake. And those were great photos. And we've done a lot of reporting with Rabbi Abrahamson on that topic. That's been really interesting. Way to learn about Bedford.
Mm-hmm.
So we try to have as many people out there covering as many things as we can.
Okay. What do you wish you had that you don't to get your job done?
With the way the internet is, the way social media is, I have a lot of resources at my fingertips. And the greatest resource that maybe that wasn't there in the past is that direct communication with residents through social media. In the morning I can wake up and know that I'm going to do a story on a certain topic and, send a message out to all those people on social media saying, how do you feel about this? I want to put your opinion in. I want to get your experience into our story. For example, when I did a piece with one of our other reporters on how businesses have been affected by the bad winter, I reached out through Facebook and said, if there's any local business owners, please reach out to me. I'd love to get your personal perspective on how the snow affected your sales and patronage. So that was really nice.
And in doing that, did you get an adequate response?
Mm-hmm. I think so, yeah.
So people are participating.
Oh, yeah, that. Yeah. It's a slow thing. Sometimes not everybody wants to be in the paper, and that's fine.
Yeah.
But it's been really growing, even in the last couple of months that I've been here.
Good. Mm-hmm. So now, as you do, let's say a letter to the editor that I would write, that is, let's say a bit curmudgeon-y, okay? Because I can write those kind of letters.
Sorry.
Would you edit that and say, well, and then at the bottom of the article say, we couldn't say all the things that this writer said, but this is the gist of it. Or do you just kind of...
If there's
as long as it's tasteful, let's say.
Sure, there's a level of taste that goes in there. We can't run any words that you wouldn't say out in public or things like that. And we can't really run information that we can't back up.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be about it. And if I had questions, I would call. I always call to confirm letters, so they're not just coming from one person who wrote it and it's being attributed to someone else. We always like to know that it's coming from the person that it says it is. And then if I had questions on the subject matter, I'd, give that person a call and run down with them and see how they felt about, changes or that type of thing.
So that one of the interesting things at the town election, which was held two Saturdays ago,
mm-hmm.
we knew the results at the end of Saturday, sometime Saturday night.
Right.
Can you take that and get it out in front of us by way of social media prior to the publication of the paper on Thursday? How does that work in your office?
Yes, I absolutely did that. So I went to the polls like I've done forever. And you wait and you have see the tape print out, and then I add up the numbers and I send them out on social media. But we make sure to say that those are preliminary, especially if there's absentee ballots that need to be counted.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, as I'm writing my story, the town clerk will post the official result up on the website. I'll include that, and then we'll put either the full story or a smaller version of what's coming out in the paper up onto our website right away. So that's what happened two Saturdays ago. We first did social media of the winner is, and then I put up the full story maybe 2 hours later once I got the results from the town clerk.
So you guys have the resources and apparently the skills to give us almost daily news that's important.
Mm-hmm.
So we should travel to your website more than frequently to get what the news is.
Yeah, definitely. Like, for example, after town meeting, I put up a smaller version of what's going to come out in our paper, so a little taste of what that story is going to be like with the most important information. And then, you know, we'll have additional information in the larger story that's going to come out on the 2nd.
Well, great. Our time's about up, but thank you for coming to our town and being one of our key reporters.
Oh, thank you so much for having me.
It's nice to have you here.
It's great to be
here. Thank
you. Thanks.
You wouldn't let money just blow out of your house. So when your AC or heater is on, make sure the doors, windows, and fireplace flue are shut tight. If you're headed out, turn down the AC. Or lower the heat by 10 degrees. And always keep your water heater set at 120. A little bit of common sense goes a long way. Get more great tips at energysaver.gov.
Okay, welcome back to Bedford Common. This segment of the show this evening, we have a couple of folks from the Bedford Rotary Club. We have Bob Cassidy over here, and over here is Linda Cargiulo. And they're here to talk with us about some of the aspects of the Rotary, particularly how we might be and are helping out the country of Haiti. Incidentally, though, while before the show I was chatting with Bob, he and I ran into each other back in the early 80s when he was the head of the DPW in Bedford. So welcome back to Bedford, Bob.
Thank you.
You did good work back in those days.
Thank you very much.
So why don't you discuss the program here, and I'll ask you some questions that the audience may want to know about, but just tell us what it's about.
Well, basically, the country of Haiti is impoverished, which is no surprise to anyone. Lots and lots of folks in lots of groups are trying to help, and we're part of that helping hand, if you will. We teamed up with a group from the Carolinas called Stop Hunger Now, and they deal with schools that already have luncheon programs in their facilities. We will package a meal. You're seeing a package here that is enough in that, believe it or not, for 6 meals. And we package each meal for 29 cents.
And then it goes to Haiti some way.
Well, they send it to Haiti.
Okay. So let's state that again. There's enough for 6 meals here.
That's correct.
And the whole package costs 29 cents or 29 cents per meal?
29 cents per meal.
Right.
So what's in that package?
Well, there's rice, soy product, soy meal, which is the protein. There's dehydrated vegetables, and there's a protein and vitamin pack in there. It's all vegetarian because this doesn't only go to Haiti, it goes all over the world, and there's some areas of the world that they don't eat meat, they're vegetarians. It has to go to a place where they could read the instructions. So that's why Stop Hunger Now has teamed with schools. The people there are literate. They could read the instructions. They have clean water. They have cooking facilities. They can't be sent home because the parents won't know what to do with this. So it encourages the parents to send the kids to school because this way they'll get one meal a day. And in many countries, including Haiti, that is the only meal these kids will get. When they don't have school, they don't eat.
So the food primarily, the meals primarily go to children?
To children.
In schools.
To children in schools.
Okay.
It encourages the children to go to school and stay in school through lunch. They, you know, normally would be sent home at the lunch break because there was no way to feed them to get half a day's education. This way they get a full day's education.
Okay. So how does the packaging process work?
You're
involved. Oh, it's fun.
Let's tell us enough about it so that we understand it.
Part of what the group Stop Hunger Now does is they supply us with all the raw materials. It comes in, it's all packaged in 50-pound containers, etc. They supply all of the equipment that you need to actually package it, and each one of these packages is obviously sealed. They take care of that. They supply all of the the cardboard boxes and the labels that go on the boxes. They take care of all of the shipping to actually get the completed meal packages to the schools.
Mm-hmm.
We have tables set up where there are between 8 and 10 people at it, and they have competitions to see how fast can you package a meal. And it's amazing, because every time you package 1,000 meals, they
ring a gong.
One of these Chinese gongs.
So where is the packaging done? Is it locally, I presume?
Middlesex Community College has offered their facility last year and again this year at no cost to us to do all of the packaging and the facilitating and everything.
And right this there. Is at the cafeteria up there?
It's for the common room, the cafeteria, okay. the student center. Okay. And it is a perfect setup for this kind of thing. We have a big entry hall where we have sponsors that will have their tables there talking about what their products are. So we encourage people to patronize them and talk to them. And then there's this gigantic room that's filled with tables for packaging, sealing, and weighing. These all have to be the same exact weight.
Okay. So how many students are involved on a given packaging session?
Well, we last year, we had three sessions.
Uh-huh.
And there are people from in their late 80s to kids that are 10 or 15 years old, and they're all equally as enthusiastic about actually trying to do something like this.
Okay.
And last year we packaged 132,000 meals.
132,000, he said, folks.
Yeah, that's
132,000 meals.
And not only that, we had little kids who couldn't even reach the tables, okay? And we stacked bags of rice so they were up on the rice so they could reach everything, you know, because we have bins of rice, bins of soy, bins of vegetable product, and they're all, you know, taking a turn putting one thing in the bag and then running up and down the aisles to get them weighed. and so all ages. We had the elderly folks who didn't want to do the running, sitting and sealing and weighing, and the kids were the runners. And everybody had a great time. And each two-hour shift went so fast that people kept saying, it's over, you know?
So now, who provides the equipment for the sealing? And
I mean, Stop Hunger Now. Stop Hunger Now.
They supply everything.
Stop Hunger Now provides all the equipment.
Yeah.
That's right.
Okay. And that 29 cents covers the food and all of their equipment.
Okay.
And the shipping.
So let's get that number again. 132,000 times six, right?
No.
That was meals. Total meals.
Total meals.
Yes.
Okay.
Total meals.
The number of bags.
The number of bags was
divided by six.
Okay.
So this and we know that it gets there.
It gets there, and that's the thing that we teamed with Stop Hunger Now. They have done all of the research and only will send to countries where they have teams in place to accept this. There's other Rotary clubs, there's various churches that are their partners on the land. So when it gets shipped to Haiti, when it gets shipped to Guatemala or wherever, Mali, it goes to where they're supposed to be mm-hmm. going. And being monitored so that the schools will get this.
Okay. Now, last week, my wife and family, there were six of us in my family, over at Flatbread Pizza, where some of the proceeds from that evening, what, 10%?
No, that was $3.50 for a large pizza and $1.75 for a small pizza.
Okay. So
came back to the Rotary Club.
Okay, so you raised over
$1,200? We raised over about $1,200 between that and our raffle.
Okay.
iRobot gave us a Roomba,
okay.
And we had some other nice raffle prizes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And next week?
Next week, Ken's Deli right here in
right
the center.
Across the street.
Mm-hmm.
Right through
has,
that window there.
Yeah, as a matter of fact. Tuesday night, or all day Tuesday.
All day Tuesday.
Please go to Ken's.
Ken's Deli.
Because he's going to give us 10% of everything that comes through the door. Mm.
Okay, now, the time frame in which this occurs, it's the month of April?
Month of April.
Yeah, okay. The month of April, and the meal package event itself will happen April 25th, which is a Saturday.
Okay, now is that the last session of three or is it first?
No, that's it.
That's it for the day.
That's it, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The sessions that maybe we misled you, they're 2-hour sessions and we did it kind of one right after the other.
So you're packaged for 6 or 7 hours.
That's
correct.
And packaged 132,000 meals.
Yes. We did.
Isn't that great?
That was wonderful. It was such a sense of accomplishment and everybody there, no matter what the age, they got it. The little kids got it. You know, when the time was up, one little kid said, "We can't stop now. There's kids who are really hungry and need this food, Mommy." You know, and she was just so glad. That was Noah. So glad that she brought him so he could see, you know, what we're doing and what people like us who have a lot. I mean, you know, we have nothing to complain about. If we don't give back, who's gonna do it? Yeah. And so these children saw that their parents are doing this, you know?
So you mentioned give back, and this is about the last thing we'll have to say. What is the...
Pay it forward. There was a film several years ago called Pay It Forward. Scenario was that this social studies teacher gave his students an assignment to come up with an idea that's will really change the world. And they all said, "Oh, you can't, we're just kids, we can't do it." And this one little boy came up with the idea that if he does three things for people, one thing for each person, three people, something important, and then instead of asking them to pay, you know, give him back, that they do something for three people, and those, that will affect a change. And that's where this Pay It Forward, it's a global thing now. And April is Pay It Forward Month. And one of our members, Diana Jarvis, is associated with the schools, is running this program, Pay It Forward, through the schools. Each school has a different thing because the ages of the kids would require different treatment. But at Lane School, Middle School, Davis School, and the high school, they're all doing something a little different. But still basically pay it forward, doing something nice for other students, for neighbors, for the teachers, and to cap off the whole month of April, we decided to do this meal packaging event.
Super.
Last year, and everybody wanted to do it again, so we're doing it this year again.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming in this afternoon.
Thanks for having us.
And can I just mention one more thing?
You can mention several
more. We need people to sign up for volunteers. Go to our website, bedfordmarotary.org, and look for the Pay It Forward link. And on that link, you'll find a sign up to volunteer and to donate. We need money bad. We don't have as many sponsors as we had last year. And if you think 29 cents a meal, if somebody would donate $29 who's going to be coming that day to package with their family, that would pay for 100 meals.
Okay. So Bedford, to give us the...
BedfordMARotary.org.
BedfordMARotary.org. Donate, folks. And thank you guys for coming
in.
Thank you for having us.
Hey, that's it for this week for Bedford Commons. Nice talking to you.